definitely didn't feel that way after the other version.
Yeah.
It was more like, it was okay, it was on TV a few times, but I think this one definitely stepped it up. What do you guys think?
I do remember specifically the subway shot when you captured all of us, you know what I mean? Just for a moment, how we were all kind of looking off. And just specifically, yes. I remember too in the ending. Oh, okay.
These blue eyes. You have to leave.
That wasn't the clip, but oh. Yes, but I have more, but it's for the other video, so I won't stop. This is kind of weird without the sound, and I can't.
You sang it so good last night. We'd rather hear you talk now. All right, back to iMag, please. Thank you. There we go.
John, you were saying something earlier. I mean, did you feel like it was your...
No, this is just bringing back so many memories. I don't think I've seen that video in, good Lord, years. No, it's just really good to see that, relive that moment. Like, I mean, for me, doing that video was really special because it was just... It was our first time that I felt like we were professionals, you know? Yeah, it's just so many great memories. So good. Aww.
Well, what was interesting to me is that, like you said... I watched that when I was 13 years old. Why were you running around a graveyard?
Hold on.
Hellhole number two.
I was...
Hellhole number two.
There we go. On the video shoot, I was asking the same thing.
Why are we running around a graveyard? It's kind of, you know, not cool.
That's on Doug. Go ahead.
That's because we didn't need a permit. So.
Since I saw the movie Easy Rider, I don't know if you see it, it's the graveyard where they trip out.
another team.
One good thing I have to say about that video, we shot that at another famous club in New Orleans called Tipitina's. And it was a jazz club. And we just went out, you know, it was
what was funny. Damn, these pictures.
After we finished that Janet Jackson.
Are these your pictures, Doug?
Yeah,
these are amazing pictures. To Doug, oh my gosh, you got some great pictures. Because we've seen every possible picture we could, the fact that we have new pictures is very cool.
That's it, Patinas.
Tyrone Proctor, rest in peace. He was the choreographer for the video.
Jordan, yes.
Jordan did the choreography for the right stuff, but Tyrone became our overall choreographer.
So Tyrone, by the way, if you remember, please don't go girl video, but all that stuff when we were up, where were we, in Harlem or?
Yeah, Harlem.
Yeah, so we'd be on this side of the street. That's amazing. We'd be on this side of the street. And Doug, I think you'd be in like the street. So we'd be, you know, doing our thing. And I've been swearing less and less, but I have to swear for this one. And Tyrone would be on the other side. We could go,
That's right, motherfuckers. Go, motherfuckers. That's right. Good. You remember that? More energy. More energy. He was amazing. He was amazing. He was our choreographer and our, like, hype man. He was amazing.
Amazing.
He was the best. And I still keep going back to, like, I can't believe you only... Now, did you have more roles in film because the first week? Okay.
They gave me, like, 30 roles this time.
Now, because that choreography at Tipitina's between you, like, wanting to get all your amazing shots, you know... That I remember how hard we worked up on that balcony, and we just kept drilling it and drilling it and drilling it. And yeah, Tyrone was probably cracking the whip.
Stuff. So that's the
Rhythm Nation. Yeah.
They did the same thing. So the director told me, she said,
how about that?
Looked like the right stuff.
So. Who knew?
Watching the.
Not that.
So, I mean, you mentioned the Easy Rider inspiration of the scene where they're tripping on acid. Aside from that scene, how much else were you all influencing the creative?
How much acid did we do?
Right? The Easy Rider scene, they're tripping on acid and they're running through this graveyard. So I saw the little bit of inspiration for that, for the video. But how much else was inspired by all of you at that point?
I think just the fact that you see what we brought to the table. And Doug was just fantastic and knew what he was doing. So it wasn't, we didn't think about the concept. We were just, let's go, you know what I mean? We were like fucking Broncos.
Well, it seemed to me that more of your personality was shown in this one, right? Like you felt like you could be a little bit freer, maybe knowing Doug a little bit more, there's a trust.
I think we were just like very enthusiastic kids, you know, where we were loving every day, every minute of what we were doing. And I think Doug was just trying to, one, contain it and also just kind of show the essence, you know, in a little more polished way.
It's fun. Remember, you got behind the wheel of the car. Do you remember? You had no driver's license or whatever. But that's at the top of your minutes. Remember you were spinning the car in circles?
I don't know. I don't think it was my idea, but I'm glad you thought of that little concept, that little opinion. That was super fun. Just everything about the video. I mean, you just captured those shots. So did you have the same editor, or did you edit it?
Yeah, you know, all of the ones we did, except for the...
this one's for the children. Around the World.
Yeah, right. It's got John Murray. So after I would shoot it, I'd go back, and we'd sit together, and we'd cut it. And yeah. So there was a look and a feel, I think, that was, similar. And he did the concert, too, the live one we did.
They have these things, it's... On Bourbon Street, I guess you could buy them back then, and these guys kept laughing a lot after the shoot. We were like, what's so funny? And they're like, it's these things. It's the dentist nitrous. Is that what it is? Is that what it's called?
Nitrous oxide.
It's like a little can, and you go, whippets. Yeah. And then you laugh for about 5 minutes.
Wait, I'm glad... We weren't the only ones doing these. You guys seem like you've all experienced the same thing.
Well, we may have indulged in a few laughing fits, I'll just say that. And we may still be trying to...
What is this shit? Oh, fuck it, I'll try it. Because his crew, they were like all about it, so... Give it a go. It might calm you guys down, actually.
Oh, it's
a disaster, this whole thing. But you guys were way more interested in girls than anything artificial. So it was...
Doug, your enthusiasm definitely inspired us. Because We were still, even though we were game on and stuff, it was a lot of your infectiousness really inspired us, because we didn't really know why we were in a cemetery, and you never told us about the Easy Rider story, or we would have been like, oh, Easy Rider, okay, we're cool, let's do it. But, you know, you would react to little things. I remember, well, it might tee up the next video, actually, but I remember, like, people would do things like an I'll Be Loving You Forever video. Someone was playing pool and did something, and you'd be like, oh, I love that, do that. Like, you always picked up on things, and it inspired us, you know, it gave us confidence. We had a lot of self-confidence regardless, but, you know, we're in a new realm now, working and making official, real, as John said, music videos, and sometimes you need that boost that, you know, what we're doing actually is cool, and you are so cool, and your crew is so cool, that when you inspired us, we did go for it, like Jordan said. We jumped on the back of the car and do whatever it was, and it allowed us to be free and to indulge in that personality that, you know, I think resonates with everyone here, and you know, that thing we share, that fun and silliness, and not taking ourselves too seriously all the time.
Do I'll Be Loving You Forever. So can we watch that clip of that?
When you had the chicken wing, and you even like put the chicken wing, didn't you have a corn dog or something like that?
Right at the basketball game, that wasn't. I don't want to make light of it, but what happened there? Yeah, where was the hoop, Doug?
That was the first one. Well, again, we were just like, I knew that the East River, and I wanted the bridge in the back. And I thought we had basketball courts, but when we got there, it was handball courts.
Yeah.
So I said, hey, why don't you guys like to play basketball? Donnie said, but there's no hoop. So we made it, they made it work. Like, you know, it was a handball with a basketball
court. Right. Yeah. Remember how you ran around the cemetery against your will? Play basketball against your will. Trust me, I'm good.
So as a 12-year-old, I just have to say, who are the girls in this video? Because as a 12-year-old girl, I hated them with a passion.
Since we had more money, we were able to, the producer, you know, cast some models in New York. I don't remember their names, but they were.
I won't find them, but I.
I honestly would love to know where they are today.
Yeah.
Wait, what?
Who, which one? Get down here.
Wait, is this for real?
Wait.
You were in the video? You were at the bottom of the bridge? We already... What?
Yeah, but... Who? Whoever it was, stand up, please. Is that you in the white?
No, you didn't get paid. You just...
Wait, you were in the high school gym at the performance. You were at the bridge. When we came down the bridge, you were there waiting.
Oh,
she didn't hate you. She hated the girls at the pool hall. She loved you. She wanted to be there with you, but she hated the pool hall girls.
Not to skip back, but it took me 30 years to know that one of the girls in Please Don't Go Girl was Rebecca Romaine. Is that true?
Yeah. That is true.
That is
yes.
True. One of the two girls.
Wow.
Straight up. In Please Don't Go Girl. Speaking of those girls in I'll Be Loving You Forever, do you remember you had to make another edit to that video?
Please
you got a note.
I'll Be Loving You.
From my mother.
She?
My mother, God bless her. She, made me cry again. I wasn't crying then. I was like, oh God. She called Donnie Einer, the president of CBS, and said, get that cleavage out of the video. There was too much cleavage. There's still a little cleavage. Yeah, she went over the pool table. On Delancey Street.
No. Delancey, at the end of the thing, you did come over to me and say, hey, Tom, can you introduce me to that girl over there?
And was that outside? Or
outside. And I remember saying, why don't you go do it? Hey, come on.
So, oh, really?
That's all I remember. Yeah.
Didn't have the swag.
I didn't know you were involved in that. That's a whole other panel, actually. Well. That panel... That would be riveting, that panel. That goes way deep, actually. So that will be Blockcon 2028. 4 years from now. Yeah.
Well, I was hoping to tie the loose end on that story and we'll find out what happened. But do you remember that? Asking Doug to introduce you to
I'm not kidding. That was not a joke, what I said.
She may continue next time.
Yeah, it's... Yes.
So, to action to seeing these videos now, one after the other, you mentioned you haven't seen them in years. You know, what is it like to see all of these again in front of all your super fans, the ones who, you know, grew up with you? I mean, what are the... Are you feeling anything different now?
For me, that song was my mother's favorite song. So, I remember at some point, you know, things were kind of moving fast and we were going to shoot the video and I called her and talking about other stuff and she said, what's the next video? And I said, so I'll Be Loving You Forever. And she said, tell them don't mess it up. But I knew, and I told her, it's Doug, you know, it's gonna be great. Turned out great. So when I see it, when Jordan sings it,
it brings me back to my mom.
Jordan, you sang that song at your wedding? Jordan, you sang it at your wedding? Did you sing I'll Be Loving You Forever at your wedding? Yeah.
Do you want me to elaborate?
Yeah, I did. Clearly it's an important song in your career, but also personally, you know, you all have such attachment to it, but also, you know, it's important enough for you to have it at your one of your most important days in your life, so I think it's very sweet.
So. It's a song I definitely, don't cry, Jordan, because when you cry, it's not pretty. It's ugly. No, it's definitely a song that, like, yeah, I think of a lot of, oh boy, a lot of people in my life when I sing that song, and I think of all of you as well, and I think of the guys, I think of my mom, and I think of just everybody. It's a special song to sing. Yeah.
So, when you first started with
Just a quick time out, Jordan's crying. He didn't want anyone to see him.
Yeah. He's actually taking a piss.
Old porn theater, is that what?
Hellhole number three.
It was a theater called the Mayan Theater, which is now a venue in LA, but back then it was just a band. It was an old porno theater. So what we had to do
was, let's get the new kids and their teenage fans down to that porno theater.
But what we had to do for that, at that point, the record, we were doing a number of things. We were doing a live concert video. So the record company said, we want to have a live concert video, then we want you to make this last video and put some documentary together, and we're going to release that as a standalone thing, like four videos of documentary. So I spent time in Vegas shooting them. They were on tour. And then we went to that theater and built a set. And we sent in a whole cleaning crew for like 2 days.
Oh, thank goodness. Acid, bleach.
This was on a tour bus from Vegas to LA.
Yeah.
There's your
biscuit.
Oh, that's that scene, right? Yeah, that was... We were just getting ready for a scene, and this ended up being the scene. No. We haven't changed my style. And see, I'm getting sad that this is like the last video almost already. You know, you say, you know, all this happened in like a year.
Yeah, every 3 months we made a video.
Yeah. Oh my God. Oh my goodness.
Biscuit, the tour before this, Biscuit was with NWA. What? We met Eazy-E and everyone with Biscuit backstage at a concert. And they were all like, Biscuit. We were like, hey! And we all hung out together and, straight to the New Kids after that.
Drive.
Yeah. And then Don let me drive.
But the funny thing was, we'd all be in the back of the bus. And then the bus is rolling down the street. The bus driver would walk in and we're all like, what the fuck is going on?
Joey stole cars, Donnie stole buses, we were renegades! Anyway, alright, back to the video.
Yeah, I mean, we still had so much energy, I think you could see how it elevates, and, you know, just seeing it all chronologically, I mean, wow, that was...
That's in the desert, right, in Vegas?
Remember this in the signboard?
What'd you say, Dan?
That was the Electrics Neon Graveyard in Las Vegas.
Now it's a museum.
But at that time, it was just a raw place. I think we were one of the first people to ever shoot.
This is the OU bad place.
Right?
Here's the O.
You came up with that on the spot, that you found those letters like OU and bad. Danny, you were shooting with a Super 8 camera. You shot some of the footage we used in the...
I remember that. That was...
I need some of these pictures, Doug.
Make a book!
Okay.
Make a book!
Yeah!
Make a book!
Loving you forever, and I just filmed that. And then when we got to the edit, we were able to match it. It was slightly, we had to retune it in post, but to make it.
It's hard for us to not watch this too. Sorry, guys. Like, we're supposed to be talking, but it's just.
I mean, this is the VHS tape, and I know, like, you guys. You watched this until it disintegrated.
Videos, and then there was Hang It Tough Live, which were all shot together over a couple of days between Vegas and California. But if I remember correctly, and Danny knows the stats, they were the two biggest selling long form videos in history. Hang It Tough and Hang It Tough Live, thanks to you guys.
There was a third one, right?
Well, I was going to say, this video was the only thing of New Kids nominated for a Grammy back then. That we were nominated for Best Long Form Video. And, I remember, we were happy that we were nominated, but I think it may have been Janet Jackson. Somebody beat us. There's the OU bad. But we were backstage at the Grammys, and the president of the Academy was walking by, and I said, "Really, dude?" Really, because we were presenting Best Rap Album for the first time on TV, which is an incredible honor. But he walked by and I said, "Really, man?" He was like, "What are you saying?" I was like, "All them songs, all them albums sold, all this and that. We only got nominated for the Best Long Form Video." And he said, "Well, you guys are just getting started, you know, don't worry about it. You know, if you last 30 years, we'll see what happens." And I'm not saying what he really meant, but what he really meant was, you guys will be gone in a month, so don't worry about your Grammys. You're lucky we gave you anything. Us, it was the judgment of all of us. They thought you guys would stop caring. They thought we wouldn't last or we didn't have time. It was a collective. It's okay. This isn't about the love that we share. It's not about any of that. But it is kind of fun to watch that and remember that conversation and know that we're all still here together doing it and celebrating. The meaning of this stuff has so much more value eternally for all of us than any award could ever have given us anyway. This is just, to do this now is so much more important than looking at a trophy that could be sitting on a mantelpiece or something like that. It's truly special. And that comes with growth, so thank God I was able to learn that lesson myself.
As a fan, as you said, I played that tape every day after school until it basically fell apart. But it was the first time that we got to see you off camera. You know, at that point, there was no social media, there was nothing, there was a lot of gatekeeping at that point. And I remember watching this and feeling so connected to you in those minutes. And, you know, as a fan, I look back very fondly on this tape. And when I was rewatching it for this panel, I can remember every single word. I can almost recite the dialogue watching the video up there. But, you know, was that a conscious effort to introduce us to who these guys were off camera? Or was that just sort of what happened through the course of filming?
Well, I mean, the record company said we want something to go between the videos, right? So I just went out and, you know, started shooting documentary. Like I said, in Vegas, they were on tour. And then we went to L.A. Remember we shot that pillow fight? I don't know if we destroyed a hotel room. It was just feathers everywhere. And, we shot great stuff, which I'd love to be able to find that footage. Because we could only fit so much in the, I think it was a 30-minute long video.
We shot a scene with a girl. You guys would have hated her. But it was at a beach. Do you guys remember that? Do you remember that? There was like a storyline, like a bus with a girl at Venice Beach or something, wasn't it?
We're all walking. Yeah, exactly.
Didn't make the cut.
I think it was just there was no room. You know, they said it had to be 30 minutes. And the videos were 18 minutes themselves, I think, when you add those up. So we only had 12 minutes.
I remember a great moment for me in that actual Hang It Tough video. We went to the LA River, and for the guys who really love hip hop in the group, so many iconic hip hop videos were shot in that little square at the LA River. It's like a long alley that takes you down, and that's where they shot. That was Thunder Road in Greece as well, down there where we shot. So we were in that little window shooting, and you know, it's always a little awkward when you start miming and you're in that, like, out in the weird space miming and stuff, but we felt really great about being there. But I remember Joe grabbed, I think you grabbed the bat, and we just started rocking out on one of the takes, and like this just energy just swept through us, like, and Joe, I think you really were the catalyst for it. Just this great energy, and like it was another one of those moments. We're doing the video, we're loving it, we're like, oh my God, we're in this cool spot where like everyone shoots these cool videos, and like this moment of ownership just came where it became like, okay, this is our spot now. This is where we're gonna make our stamp on this iconic location. It was like, I really felt it was energized when you took that bat and started playing the guitar and shit. It just really was so inspiring, and I think it swept through all of us. And I just remember feeling a real camaraderie in that moment that was so magical.
A single parent to be seen.
They were all teenagers though, but they weren't a lot of, we started to have a ton of like 5-year-olds, right? But I mean, back then our fans were still like kind of our age. So that might have been it too, right?
If I remember correctly, that was also a matinee. The live concert was like shot at 1 p.m, so it was like a matinee performance. It wasn't like midnight.
No, but I remember, Joe, we used to have a parents' room backstage, like for people where your parents could go and hang out while you guys watched us on stage. It was, yeah, it's funny, my parents' room.
Well, it's funny to watch it now. I mean, you wore the iconic orange shirt last night for us from the video. Joe, your hat with the hole on the top, you know, and your homeboy sweatshirt. I mean, all of these things are so iconic to us. Were you making these choices? I mean, to how you were visually going to be presenting yourself? Were those just choices that you made on the fly? I'm just curious now.
I mean, I think most of the things I wore, they were presented to us. Like, they bring all these clothes in and you say, oh, I like that or I hate that. The Knights baseball shirt, I think they came from like some thrift store. And they, I actually still have that in my closet. It, I wish it fit me. It don't.
We didn't have, I mean, what's to mind is during that, you know what I mean? We were still, again, this all happened in 1 year. 1 year. And when you're that age, I mean, a year can feel like 10 years. So at the time, you know, it wasn't like this is so fast. But, you know, we didn't have a lot of money back then. And, you know, so Donnie had that jean outfit. The jean jacket and jeans matching. And he wore that for about 6 months, and then he turned it inside out for another 6 months. So a lot of this, you know, yes, I mean, for the video, you know, we would have, you know, a cool, you know, leather jacket or something like that, but all that behind the scenes, though, I mean, I was rocking a fanny pack in Vegas with some t-shirt on. I'm like, what, we just grabbed anything. So our look was like a mixture of like, just super regular, but you know, when I look at it, it's like that is an interesting choice, though. This orange shirt, I mean, but everybody had their own style. When I look back at it, even though you know they gave us stuff, John always had like his style, it was always had a very distinct, like you know, shirt on. It was always something like that had a real pop to it.
It's funny, everybody thought I was like Mr. Batman. Because I had a like, Batman shirt on every day. And it was really because I wore that a Batman shirt and I'll be loving you forever. And since that video, all of you started sending me Batman shirts. So I was just like, fuck it, I got all these Batman shirts. I don't have a shop. You just throw a new one on every day. And I was just Mr. Batman. So
that's... You all have one more video that you worked on together, which is Danny Wood's absolute favorite, right? This one's for the children. Can we watch a clip of that? For you, Danny.
Sometimes,
this is a very serious message. So all of you, please listen.
In this world, no shit. So once we get to the video, I was like, this ain't even a Christmas song, you know what I mean? It was like a Christmas song. What are we doing? So it's more about that. I mean, obviously what Doug shot was beautiful, and, but I'm not really in the video much, so as a young guy, like I don't care now, but as a young guy, you're like, I'm in the group, man. That would have been my only note to you, Doug. But I didn't like the song, so I didn't really care much.
I was with Danny the other day. Sorry, my voice is shot. Danny the other day, and I said, we're going to have Doug do the panel. And, you know, I said, we got to do this one for the children. And he said, and I was like, no, it'll be fun. Everyone has feelings about it. He goes, man, that kid in the striped shirt was in the video more than me.
Somebody photoshopped Danny's face on that kid.
We'll do a redo.
So there was a campaign somebody started on social media. I think it was Rat Tail or somebody, like, save, free the kid in the striped shirt. Like, now you know why. Nobody, it's not that we didn't like him, it's just we didn't want him to take Danny's place in the band. That's all it was.
Well, you know, I think when we shot that the performance, it was where everybody was sitting around the table. I think, were you on the other side? I can't remember. But where we sat, that's where we were.
When you got one guy dead center going, then you can't compete with that. You can't.
There's no. Hold on. Because this is like, to me, this is basketball with no hoop part two. The song was fading out. The song was fading out. And we started getting goofy. This one's for the children. And I started doing this shit. Just being silly at the end. I was goofing around. And this is five videos in. You had a whole bunch of film now, right? I'm like, we're goofing around one take. The edit came and the first thing in the video is me kicking my feet like, what the fuck? And he went around filming people. What was the budget on this video?
Yes. Here's the thing with that video that was different. I had moved to Paris and I was living in Paris. And so I came up with this thing to shoot kids around the world. But when we edited it, I shot it in New York, the performance part, and then I had to get a new editor. I couldn't work with my normal ones.
And so the guy who was so good.
So we cut it in New York, and then I had to leave for another job, and the editor worked with the record company to finish the video. And it really never, it wasn't edited the way I would have edited.
You could tell. I didn't even know you did this video. It makes sense. I mean, we only did the performance, you know. You could tell, I can see the quality of the shots, but like the rhythm of it is probably a little off, and not off, but just different from what you normally do. So makes sense.
I mean, that, you're so busy, they only had one day to shoot it, so it's like you got this one day to shoot them in New York. So the rest of the stuff, I just got two guys to help me. We traveled the world shooting kids. Which was an interesting experience.
Where was that? Where was that?
I'll tell you what happened. Is we were going to film in Egypt. So we flew from Paris to Egypt, but the producer didn't get a permit for us. You know? So we arrived.
Never stopped us before.
Gaddafi, the Libyan dictator, had come that day to Egypt, and the Egyptian authorities thought we were there to film him, that we'd snuck into the country. So they arrest us. In this cinder block jail at the end of a runway and say, you got to get on the next plane out of the country the next day, which happened to be going to Greece. So we went to Santorini and found these kids, and that's the kid on the donkey you don't like.
Oh, well, I never said I didn't like the kid.
And they came and got us at like 4:30 in the morning, put us on the next flight out, which was to Athens.
And you kept going. You're like, after this.
Then we went to Moscow after that and to Bangkok after that. We circled the... I mean, nowadays you could just buy stock footage of kids, but at that
time...
Stock footage of anybody. You sick bastards. I could just see you in that prison going, the right stuff, you know the right stuff? Shut up. You're on the next plane tomorrow at 4:30. But I'll be loving you forever, no? You ask about this energy and... We can hear you.
It's funny, a lot of people ask me that, Bauhaus, and I still don't know who they are. It's a band. Is it a band?
It's a goth band.
A goth? Oh. It's fine. They kind of just laid a bunch of shirts out, and I thought that shirt went the best with my jacket, basically. But it got a lot of attention, and a lot of people
over the years have said, I like that Baja shirt, man. Like, a lot of people, like, thought I was, like, cool or something because I wore that shirt, but I'm not familiar with the band.
That's funny because whoever our stylist was brought, like, all these, like band t-shirts. Because me as well had some punk rock band on my t-shirt. And I didn't know who it was either. It was a cool shirt.
Yeah.
You all upstairs, obviously you have a lot of your archive of fashion that you guys have been keeping over the years, and you've been posting some on social media. Donnie, I want to know whether those ripped jeans still fit you.
He just said, do you still have them? No, the overall... He said, what, the overalls? I wore those last night. There was a concert we did. I think you were there.
No, I knew, though. I saw the overalls.
I have the ripped jeans. I did an Instagram post of the ripped jeans. Because I wasn't thinking they could fit. So I just posted it because it got me emotional. You know, a lot of this old stuff gets emotional. So, I did try them on, and I wasn't going to, but when I did the post, everybody was like, you better wear those at Blockcon, you better wear those at Blockcon. Not everybody, but a lot of you. So I did try them on, and they do fit. Sort of. I can show you right now if you want. Except,
wow.
I made one new rip. Yeah, I got them on and they wouldn't button, so I figured it's better to expose the back than the front. And there they are. Oh, I got them up to go. There you go.
Gorgeous. Thank you, Donnie.
I don't know, I hope you guys didn't get impacted. I couldn't breathe last night for half the show because I was like, ugh. So if anything befalls me in the next few weeks, it's Blockcon and bringing out all these old clothes for you guys and breathing in toxic fumes from my storage unit.
The Batman belt, I don't know where it is. I don't know what that was in Hanging Tough, right? Yes.
Where's your rat? Where's your goddamn rat?
You know what? I might have it somewhere. My mother kept that thing. She's a bit of a pack rat. She's very sentimental. And she hangs on to a lot of those past things. And I think either my mother has it somewhere, or I might have lost it. But I did keep it for a while. Anyway.
Last night, you guys.
Just being with everybody, I think that's always a favorite of mine.
Zach, who do you have?
Danielle. Last night, my daughter Chance is here. And, it, you know, I'm so happy she's here to experience this, but she said, was talking about all the songs that we've not done in the past or done only a few times. And she said, you played one of my favorite songs. I was like, what? She goes, This Is Right. I was like, what? Like, I didn't even know she knew that song. And, you know, yeah, my daughter is a New Kids fan, so. Makes it easier at home, for sure.
Our kids love our music, probably hate as much as we have to travel and stuff, but they love, yeah, I know my kids do. They don't always get it, but they love it. Thank you.
Kid, how old are you, by the way?
11.
11.
Good choice.
Amazing. You know, it's pretty cool that, like, you know, our kids, you know, the generation, the younger generations, I don't think you guys really see, like, oh, this is from that area, this is from that era, or the 80s or the 90s. It's just, it's all available, so they can either like it or not, which is pretty cool. And if they like it, you know, they know where to find it. It's just, everything's out there. Baby Blockheads! Documentary.
Last night I shot footage with my iPhone, so it's already.
Hi, my name is Caitlin. I want to thank you guys so much for this opportunity. I'm a huge fan since I was 3. And I have a 5-year-old who's a huge Donny fan. So, just wanted to shout her out too. My question is what is one thing you haven't done that you still really want to do?
Oh man, so you stumped us. I mean, I know we. I know Joey had a dream to play Carnegie Hall. And let us be part of that dream. I don't know that, I personally don't know that I have a dream that clear, you know, that I can say, I really want to do this before I retire or whatever, like the Carnegie, but it's really hard to say. We work really hard and we really care and we're really focused and you know, I say this a lot, but we take what we do serious, but we don't take ourselves serious. But this is so, in some ways, beyond, you know, we never thought we'd do a convention. We've talked about it. You know, I could say a frivolous answer like we wanna be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame or we wanna do Vegas. It's really, for me personally, it's always about the next time we get to share this happiness is really what it's all about. You know, that when we meet you guys, this specific weekend more than ever, the hugs, we'll always say something quick, I love you, thank you, you know, whatever. But it's a lot of thank you for doing this more than usual, I'm hearing. Thank you for doing this. And that's really, for me, you know, what's the one thing that we haven't done that I want to do next? The next thing that I get to do with you guys. The next thing we get to do with you guys is the only thing I want to do next in my career.
Hey, I'm Pam. Donnie posted on Instagram about the jeans. Thank you for trying those on. But you were explaining that you bought those with the money from your first part-time job. So, what did you guys do for your first part-time jobs?
Danny?
Well, we... the first job I had actually... was a summer before us 3 had jobs downtown, but the first job
that I had, and it was with Danny, was at a, we were like 16, and we were counselors for little kids at a summer camp. So,
we were camp counselors for kids, but I remember we were breakdancing a lot, like, for the kids. That was, like, the one thing we could do and entertain the kids, so me and him would just be practicing entertaining all the kids breakdancing, so was a fun summer.
And then the next summer, our schools, the public schools, they would help the kids get summer jobs, and they were at a different school, but it was close by, and Donnie and Danny, and the school, I guess, maybe directed them towards some summer jobs downtown Boston, right in the middle of the city, and my school did the same. So we all ended up, like, a block away from each other having summer jobs in the middle of the city.
That was fun.
It was. There's a lot of stories that we can get into it. So I worked at, I think it was an insurance company, and I worked in the basement stuffing envelopes and running mail to different businesses and stuff and dropping them in. I was like a mail guy or whatever, stuffing envelopes and stuff like that. And I don't know exactly what you guys did.
We worked at the Shaman Bank, which I don't even think exists anymore. Yes, Shaman Bank, woo-woo. Danny, I don't know, you used to be like, my job's boring. I just sleep all day.
Mine was boring, too. We had to input numbers into, like, a computer, which, imagine what a computer looked like back then. But I was in a room with another guy from our school. I don't remember his name, but we would take naps because we'd finish the work in like an hour and then have nothing to do.
My job was really hard, actually. I didn't sleep. I worked in a foreign exchange office, and the other two interns on a summer job program were two Harvard students. So it was, they walked in the first day, and one's got a bow tie and his glasses and his suit, and the other one's in a fancy suit. And I had on white jeans, yellow sneakers, and a yellow Hawaiian shirt with a mullet. And I really thought I was dressed up. Like, I was like, I look good, I look good. And I walked in and they were like, who the hell are you? But literally within a week, I was doing exchange. Like, I was buying six-month lira and selling yen in Japan. Like, I was doing all these currency exchanges, and there was a New Kids poster in the office, and all the people in the office knew about the band. They knew that I was, you know, had this aspiration to be famous. And it was great, but honestly, all I looked forward to every day was meeting Jordan and Danny for lunch. And we had a few other friends that were working, and we would go to Wendy's and then we would just cause mischief. And then I would literally, one time we had a fight with some muscle guy. He tried to beat us up. And my ear got cut open from my earrings, and I ran back to work, and I didn't realize I came in, you know, in my shitty clothes, and I'm like, hey guys, and there was blood all over my head. And I didn't know, and they were like, what's happened to you, Mr. Walmart? But we had real jobs, but not long after that, I think maybe within a year, we went on tour with Tiffany. Maybe a year after that, or maybe two, but it was pretty soon after we went on tour, and it's been our job ever since.
There was a parking lot for the Boy Scout building, and my mom worked there, and there were so many leaves in the parking lot. You know when a place doesn't clean up leaves for like 4 years, so they're just like stacked, there's like fossils under them? And I cleaned that whole thing up, and it wasn't very fun. Actually, I had a weed whacker once, and you know, and I was weed whacking at like 3:30 after school, so there was a lot of traffic, and I was, the weed whacker flew out of my hand. I swear to God,
into traffic, like way out there, landed on somebody's hood. You know the rotary at the end of the rotary? Boom. And of course, perfect timing as it was, my friends were, there was like four of my friends packed in a car, saw the whole thing happen, of course. I needed help too. You know what I think about a lot is you guys. It's like my son Griffin would, oh God, he would fit in with you three. Oh my God. I was like 3 years younger than you guys. So, it was a big difference back then. But Griffin's, 15 now. So, he'd have fit in perfectly.
Oh, my God. Hi, I'm Nikki McCain. Thank you guys for doing all this. I served in the U.S. Navy on a warship. Served together 23 years ago. Thank you. Can I get a go Navy, please, guys? Go Navy, please.
What is it?
Can you please say go Navy?
Go Navy?
Okay. Oh, yeah, we'll do it on three. One, two.
Go Navy!
Do we get to go to high school prom?
Oh.
Made it to prom, but...
We didn't make it through high school, motherfucker. I'm younger. I was always in a higher grade than you.
It took me 6 years, but I eventually graduated.
Brilliant John is now. I mean, you were busy rebuilding your house on Melville Ave. You were always busy. It wasn't like you weren't doing anything, but like to just find the right school for kids. But you guys were.
I tried everything. My mother put me in night school. She put me in some class on Saturday, and like. Nursing home type situation. It was rough.
I remember Jeff, 1 year.
You shy?
Yeah,
I went.
I went to, we went to got in the same limo and everything. We have pictures of that.
Yeah, I have one in my photo album I found in storage. It's you, me, and Crystal. Yeah. Remember Crystal?
Yeah.
That's... You won't know her, but she's the girl who pierced my nose backstage before a concert in 1989, I think.
Yeah.
Crystal, yeah. She worked at the mall, the corner mall in downtown Boston.
So you went with Crystal?
I didn't go with Crystal. I went with Danny's ex-girlfriend.
I think she paid for the limo.
She did.
I was like, because she was in one of my classes, my science class, and I was like, you going to the prom? And she said, maybe. I was like, if you do, are you getting a limo? She's like, yeah, whatever. I was like, all right, well, let me know. So she let me know. She paid for the limo.
That's how you got me to go. Because I was like, I really can't go with Millie because Danny's going to be mad at me. And you're like, she got the limo, you got to go.
I remember, this is high school.
I had already been hearing things, from other people.
So.
People talk,
It's good. We were walking to my house, me and you, probably we were gonna hang out that weekend. And I just said, why didn't you tell me? And you were like, you felt so bad. And I'm like, I mean, I don't care. She's a nice girl, but I broke up with her for a reason. And I just was kind of letting them know. And that was kind of the conversation. And for two high school guys to just, you know, talk about it like that, it was over. You know what I mean? I didn't really care.
Thanks, Danny.
Thank you guys for doing this. My question to you is, what song has the most meaning to you?
I'll be loving you forever. That's
everything about it is just classic.
So I think we only have time for two more questions, so we'll go to Renee for
Morales from New York. New York in the house! My friends are expecting me to talk about how much I love you, Donnie, but I'm not going to do that. My question for you is, what was the first thing that each of you bought with your first paycheck that you got from the group?
I think you were there. Were you there for, you were still filming? But we were at the Gibson Theater. I mean, we used to get like some money. I remember we had a baby car for the first time. But we found out, they got us all together, and it was at the Gibson Theater at Universal Studios in Los Angeles. And they told us we were all millionaires. And we went crazy because we got to have fun. It was just another opportunity to go nuts, and Danny did a backflip. Danny was the best at physically expressing our excitement. We just thought of our families. I mean, I think anybody would do that too, but I just remember that. I think it was that weekend or the next day, we all went to a hotel room and they brought us in one by one. Do you remember that? And they said, what do you want to do? And...
Wait, this is...
you don't remember that. John, don't encourage them. Don't encourage them. You can't say kids and you can't say hotel room. That's all we need to get sick in our minds about crazy shit. No. I just remember, you know, we wrote checks to our families and bought houses for our moms, and I bought a Cadillac for my dad, and that's what I remember. Yeah.
I mean, going back to the very first money, I think even before that, I honestly think I bought a washer and dryer for my mom, because for like the last few years before that, well, it was for my mom, but it was also for me, because then I wouldn't have to carry two garbage bags to the laundromat every few days, which was the most just awful thing to do. I used to have to walk by Terry Wallace's house. Jordan would be on the front porch, and I'd be like, I gotta cut through the yard so they don't know that I can't afford a washing machine. Yeah, but I think going back to that specific memory, the first thing was family. I didn't think of like, oh my God, I wanna go to an island, or I wanna do this. I called my brother Mark and I said, I gotta get a car. I wanna buy a car. What kind of car do you like? And he said, I like Cherokee, a Jeep Grand Cherokee. And I was like, okay. I didn't know what kind of car I wanted. I didn't have a dream car. I never thought I'd own a car. So I asked him, and he was like, it's gotta be black. It's gonna have a gold pinstripe. He started breaking it down, and I was like, oh, geez. So I went back to our financial manager right after that meeting, and I said, can I buy a car? And I thought he was going to say, come on, he's thinking it's going to be a Ferrari or something like that. And he was like, what kind of car? I said, a Jeep Cherokee Wagoneer, Grand Wagoneer. And he said, of course you can. And I was like, great. So I bought it. I drove it about three times, and then it became Mark's car. That was the end of that.
joy over some really hard years, the last few years. But my question is, if you had to become a new kid, what would you be doing?
Wow, I mean, I think I'm lucky enough that I am a new kid and doing what I would have been doing. Yeah, life is good.
I think I'd be running a community theater like a crazy person. Hopefully, yeah, I probably would have been doing that. In my blood, and maybe a bricklayer to pay the bills.
Go ahead, Jordan, please.
I really do. Like, I think about that sometimes. I'm like, what the hell would I be? And I think I'd probably be one of those people that like switches careers a lot. Like, never hold down a job, like, go from this one to that one, fucking get a new idea, go do this and that, like, one of those types, you know what I mean? So, yeah, I'm just, you know, I'm interested in a lot of things.
I have no idea, I don't want to know, I don't want to think about it. I shudder at the thought of it. I do pray sometimes and say thank you for not making me have to find out. I just don't know. I would hope that it would be something okay. I don't know. I mean, I swear, I walked around the streets of Boston dreaming of something like the way my life turned out, and I met Maurice Starr, and I never thought about anything else in my life other than that since 14 years old. And we had jobs, we worked. I mean, I worked for my dad 1 year, I worked with Jordan and Danny, I worked in a shoe store in Dorchester selling Adidas like this and spent all my money on clothes so I could look good to be in this band. But I don't know, and maybe there's a parallel universe where we're all somehow connected, you know, like we're taking our wives or someone to Joey's community theater on a Friday night to see a play and go, this kid from Jamaica played, he's really good, that McIntyre guy, you know. I don't know. This life is beyond surreal. And, I don't want to cry. It's amazing. And taking it back to the videos, to the beginning, you know, and maybe this can resonate for some of you guys as well. You know, we really can manifest our dreams and what we want, you know, if we really commit to it. And you guys are doing it. You're doing it too. Like, just remember that when you're mad at those girls in the I'll Be Loving You video, you know, you probably were saying things like, I want to be in a room with those guys. I want to get to know those guys. I want to be the one having fun with those guys. And you're doing it. You know, you're not showing your cleavage when Jordan wrapped his arms around you at a pool table, but it's manifest. It's manifest in its own way, and I like to think that, you know, we were all put here to be doing this very thing together right now and be an important part of each other's lives and to help each other navigate this crazy world of ours as a family. So thank you.
I want to know what Danny would have been now. Yeah.
I probably would have been a music engineer. The early recordings we did, Maurice taught me a lot in the studio and enabled me to eventually have my own studio, so I'm probably a music engineer.
Save me a dance tonight, please.
Thank you all.
with us. And Doug, thank you for coming to spend this afternoon and give us your insight. It was really interesting and helped us understand this video so much more.
You ready for the second half of the panels? Make some noise. Let's get it together here. We gotta get our energy up. I'm wearing a vest for you. Please scream. All right, here we go. Next panel of the day. The Block 15th anniversary record. Are you ready? Here it is.
If you do it the right way, nobody can take anything away from you.
I don't think any of us needed to do this thing, really. If this thing doesn't blow up, it doesn't matter. You know, we still got something to say.
I'd be lying if I said the stakes weren't high for me. You know, I walked away from my acting career.
The stakes for me are, can we work together? Can we make the album we want to make? Can we make the music we want to make?
We put the music first. The New Kids have never really been known as a music first group. We were perceived, you know, by anyone who wasn't a fan of the group as, you know, a manufactured entity that was about, you know, selling t-shirts and slippers and posters and dolls and cartoons and anything but music.
I think we never lost just five guys from Boston, and love to perform, love to entertain people. You know what I mean? That was it. That was everything. And we, like, put our heart and soul into it.
Just having their support is so comforting to me.
It is, you know, a band of brothers in a way. It's only music. We're not going into a burning building, but it is, there's something about that. It feels really good to be working with everybody else.
The song that really brought us back together was a song called Click, Click, Click.
Just for me, it was as simple as a phone call from Donnie. Send me a song. The song was good, and I was like, all right, let's do it.
I guess Donnie is their song.
Oh, okay, I get it.
It's all about the work. It's all about putting the work in, putting the time in, putting your heart into it.
Yeah. Kick the right foot in the work.
What's he fucking doing?
Look at this. Two left feet.
You know, I think we just all came at a point in our lives where we can do this right now. You know, it's like coming home again. We've been staying at. That's been a whole weird thing, just all of us, you know, camping out of the house. We have like a little frat house over there.
Sing, play ping pong, right? And the song, play ping pong, eat some food, play ping pong, go out to eat, play ping pong, go to the gym, play ping pong. It's been a ping pong fest.
We have serious ping pong matches.
Leave Brittany alone! Leave her alone! Right now!
This time around, I mean, it's everybody has family of their wives and kids to be on the road with us.
Mostly I've been being a dad, you know, I have four kids, so that's my main focus.
We just had another son who's a year old, have an 8-year-old.
Oh boy.
My son's 4 months now. I'm gonna be piggybacking him all over the world. It's gonna be hard to keep a balance between that heavy workload and being there for your family, especially when you're away. It's exciting for us, you know what I mean? It's exciting just to be back together. I'm doing this because it feels perfect.
I really don't think I'm going back. I really think I'm going forward.
now we get to talk about the album that brought you all back to us. Watched it, but that is such an interesting time in your journey to me, because you had all decided to come back together, but no one else knew. It just felt like this very private moment. Can you take us back to what it was like in that creative bubble after not having worked together for so long? Some stories here.
For me, it was... It was also like I hadn't talked to a lot of the guys in years, so we were just kind of, we were there together, and then those clips, you know, it's kind of get to know each other again.
With your Bite Me t-shirt on.
But I just, you know, a couple of years been divorced, so went through, you know, some tough times and stuff, so it was two things. It was a little awkward trying to, you know, get to know guys again, but then also it was like a saving grace for me to, you know, us to be back together. I had come out of some, you know, hard times, and I was just looking forward to being, you know, together and recording, because that's all it was Donnie played me one song, click, click, click. That was it. There was no record company, no manager, no nothing, no team of people. It was Donnie playing me a song, and then, yeah, let's do it. Let's get in the studio.
So the song, and you were like, yes, I'm back.
Yes. I mean,
it was Donnie quick. There was a 7-month period in between, let's do this, and being in the studio. Sorry.
But Donnie quick is better than Donnie soon. Let's just clear it out. Whole different thing. Actually gets results done. Just for me, two things. There's the emotion of being back together, but there's the preceding it. There was a long process, and a lot of people don't know about it because it did seem like click, 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 and here we go. But there were conversations, I'd say a year, maybe even a little bit more. I know Joey and I stayed in touch with different guys in the band differently over time. Danny and I talked all the time. Jordan and I once in a blue moon. John never called, never wrote. I missed you so bad.
Sorry.
It's okay. But Joey and I stayed in touch a lot too. And I remember, I don't know if you remember, because we don't talk about it a lot, but we would have... lunch or breakfast sometime, and I think it was at 420 in Studio City we met, and you might have actually taught me about that restaurant now, if I recall it wrong. Formel, there was a chicken salad sandwich among someone. I think that was it. It's like, you gotta get the chicken salad. Anyway, we had a talk one time, and it was really, we were both really clearly on the same page, which was, if we ever get back together, it has to start with music. It can't start with, you know, a lot of people would approach us and say, hey, you guys want to do a reunion tour with, you know, group A, B, and C, and we'll call it the 90s Live Forever Tour, or the 80s Always Tour, and we were like, nah. Like, it was always a no. And when Joey and I met, you know, it was very much like, music has to be the way. We have to want to do it again, you know, from a true place. Just started being like, this is kind of cool. This is kind of like what the New Kids could sound like now. It honors the past of New Kids. It's not too much of a departure from what we were, but it sounds like who we are might be now. And so then, yes, I shared it with Jordan, I think, in the limousine. And he really loved Click, Click, Click. You know, I was like, this other song is great too. And he was like, yeah, but this Click, 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 this is a vibe. And sent it to Joey. And Joey had mentioned in our earlier meeting, we actually set up a meeting with Jared Paul, our manager, a year before this happened. So it was kind of like that conversation planted the seed that all we needed was the music. And suddenly the music revealed itself. I didn't go searching the world for a song. The song appeared. You know, the universe put it into action. We spoke. The universe started working a year and a half later. Boom. There's the song. I remember the conversation. Let's get to work. In terms of emotionally, same as Danny, you know, it was an interesting time in my life. I was going through a lot of personal changes, and I didn't realize how much getting back with the guys first would be a lifeline for me. I love you too. I don't need to get
it. I would say we needed each other.
For sure.
At that time.
For sure. You know, that clip, in that clip, Jonathan says, we all moved into Donnie's house. You know, that was the first house I ever lived in alone in my adulthood. And I know. We all... Listen, I knew I needed you guys, and I knew I needed these guys, but I knew at the first meet and greet that we all needed each other desperately, and it was so wonderful. But those times playing ping pong and being in that house, like, those ping pong games was like, it was just, you know, the work was amazing. We're recording and doing this stuff, but the times we were just spending together again, and just, you know, rekindling this bond at a time when we were all, you know, experiencing different things in life. It was just right on time. It was just God's plan, you know, it just all worked out right on time.
In the house together, I mean, what was the dynamic in there? Was it all creative, or were you like kids again? You know, what was the environment?
It was fun. I remember I had a room on the second floor. And I think John, at one time, you were sleeping on the floor on a mattress. I was sleeping on the bed. We both woke up at like noon every day. Donnie had already been out since, you know, 7:30 in the morning or something.
Didn't you have to put like towels on the windows or curtains or something?
That would probably make sense. Something like that.
Like I said, it was the first house I lived in alone as an adult. It was pretty shitty.
It was great. It was great. And we would just mosey downstairs, and there was a little studio set up in a little room, and we would just wake up and talk and listen to music, and Nasri, who was a songwriter, would come by with some new songs and stuff. It was cool. It was like the old days. It was like us when we would go to Maurice's house and just hang out, and music would always be in the background and something we loved, but we were still living our lives together, hanging out, playing basketball. But we just replaced it now because we're older. We did ping pong instead of basketball. It was safer for us. Yeah. So it was what we wanted and what we needed, which was an environment to bond. And it came from an organic place rather than a corporate greedy place, like, let's exploit these guys or to get exploited. It was us doing what we love to do and using our own creative minds and just vibing off each other and kind of fitting back in. You know, into our roles as a group and finding out who we were now. And it's kind of funny. It was like who we were now kind of turned out to be who we were then. We just had to rediscover what we were in the group. And that's kind of what happened. We just fit in. And it was like a lot of people would say, how is it like? Is it like riding a bike? And I remember Donnie said, yeah, but it's a mountain bike this time. It's a little tougher, but... It was like riding a bike. We just kind of we got back together, and it was definitely a little awkward. Like, okay, who am I in this group now, or where do people stand? And it was like we just had to settle in and just be us. And then when that kind of settled in, it just like the magic started.
I think, you know, you speak to Nasri, but like, you know, these things work for lots of different reasons, right? It's like lightning in a bottle. Take two. I can't compete with that. Got the picture of Jordan in the shower. Well, Nasri was a hot ticket, man. He was a firecracker, you know, and it's like, it's the perfect, I mean, you know, it's all, everybody's seeing it. Obviously, like, you know, Donnie recognizing the talent, but again, Jamie Roberts, our lawyer, who's, you know, he comes from a music background too. So, and he's always been that not your average lawyer, which is pretty cool, you know what I mean? And he knew this might work, you know, which is sweet. And then you have Nasri, who was just a ball of energy. Couldn't stop writing songs. Like everything was let's go. Everything was a song, and he would big bang boom. So we had that element. His partner Adam was a great vocal recorder, you know what I mean, for us to feel comfortable. He recorded all those vocals, which was fantastic. And then, you know, it's you guys, it's the early mornings, it's the emotions, like, God, I don't want to be blathering, but like, you know, finding your role, you know, the way everyone's talking about it, like, how do I fit in again, you know what I mean? And like, you know, I'm the young one, you know, historically, you know, I gotta look out for myself, you know what I mean? You know, you get inside your head about, well, I gotta, you know, and sometimes that comes out sideways, sometimes that, you know, comes out in an aggressive way or a sarcastic way. Which was my big tool. We sick bastards. You can't say anything. You can't say tool.
I think it was so, big tool.
But the thing I remember most, well, one of the things is me and Nasri got into a fight. You know, we got into a fight because it was his personality. So it was a lot for me to take, you know, and like my competitive nature. And I look back and it's like, I look back, you know, gently and kindly, you know, to myself, you know what I mean? It's all growing pains. And I'll wrap this up, but like what this reunion, you know, on a personal level, I've shared this before, it's like, you know, I got to learn how to be an adult, you know what I mean, around other people. You learn by making mistakes, you know what I mean? In those first couple of years, it was rough going, you know what I mean? Like, sometimes there was so much joy and excitement, but, you know, that's what I remember is like, you know, and that's a big part of a group getting back together is personalities, you know, and rolling with it. And a lot of it does make sense, but, you know, to make it work, you know, you gotta learn from the mistakes. And, you know, that's what I remember. Along with, also for the music side, it was great. Like, I remember Summertime, you know, when Donnie played me Summertime, I just got hype, you know what I mean? And like, I think Donnie and I have a history of like touching base on certain music that, you know, I feel I know he's there for me, and he's always saying yes, 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 go, go, go. And I do the same. You gotta be honest, it's not all the time, but when I love a song, you know, from Summertime to, you know, Boys in the Band, you know what I mean? No one loves Boys in the Band and 80s Baby more than me, you know what I mean? So, but Summertime, I remember that too. I remember cutting that vocal in that little studio, you know, and that electricity and newness, you know. So there was a lot of that too, and it was a lot of energy in that time, you know what I mean?
For sure. Now we're doing the same thing, just in our own way, you know. I probably would have been frustrated and stuff too, and gone through different changes. But I just fortunately had just done 2 years of therapy because my marriage was ending. So I was ready to work with all personalities. Like the sarcasm would come out, and I just thought of my therapist. I'd be like, okay. He's expressing something in his own unique way. You're receiving. I'll do my best. And sometimes I would take that role. You know, we all had our journeys and discoveries. Just the thing with Nasri for me, and I'll move on. You weren't the only one that got frustrated, because like Red One is another producer we worked with. We'll get to him in a second. But Nasri would sing all the time. You guys know he sings loud. He's in Magic, and yeah. He sings "Marry That Girl, Marry Her Anyway." He's a phenomenal songwriter. He's written hits for everyone. But we were the first band that he really worked with that got his break. But I just took the approach with Nasri, besides I love playing ping pong and hanging out with him, he just would sing all the time, and I was like walking behind him like with a shovel, like shoveling the songs up and putting it in a satchel on my back. Like, he'd be like, ah, and I'd be like, that's a song, and I'd put it right here. And then literally we were at Guitar Center, and he walked up to a keyboard. We had to get a keyboard to build the studio in my house, and he just walked up and he goes, I can just stare at you forever. He was like, that's all I got. And I was like, play some more. And he played a few more chords, and I was like, I could be here with you doing whatever. And then I literally took a line from my therapist, which was, it's not the way you look that brings me to my knees, it's the way you look at me. We wrote it in Guitar Center. It just happened because I don't know, my heart was open. I was just listening all the time and looking for things. And to your point, summertime, different songs would resonate. You know, it's like I've learned from you. Like, I don't think Boys in the Band Happens or 80s Baby. I don't write those songs if I wasn't in the band with you, seeing how you write songs. You know, I think we learn from each other. It's like we learn to craft. Like, even the falsetto part, the in the 80s, baby, it was like, I heard that in the studio. It's like, Jordan, this record, we gotta make this record. This is Jordan's gonna sing up. It's like, it's when you're in the band and you know the personalities, it just, and you trust it, it just kinda, the universe will show you everything you want. It will all come to you. And in friendships, too.
Some sexual innuendo.
Oh, I don't know. It'll,
one of the words you said.
It'll come to you. What was it? I don't even know what I say. Anyway, the journey with Nasri brought us to meet Red One, who is now one of the most prolific producers in the world, who's produced Lady Gaga's album, produced Jennifer Lopez, I mean, you name it. He's one of the most iconic producers of all time.
We'll get to Red One in a minute, but Sean, I'm curious about you. You know, they were sort of motivated by the music, but what brought you back to the band?
What brought you back to
the
band?
We needed somebody with the best hair in the business. John's always complaining about his hair, and it always looks marvelous. What brought me back? I actually was going through some stuff as well before New Kids got back. Business was not doing well. It was a big crash of 08 in real estate. And I was just ready to get out of houses and all that stuff. And I think you called Jordan. And Jordan was like, somebody wants to talk to you. Well, it was you.
You know, it's more like, well, you better talk to John. I ain't fucking asking.
You brought him along for the ride the first time. He was like, yeah, not this time.
You know, and I mean, I had a lot of reservations about coming back, and I know, you know, talking to guys on the road, it was. There was a lot of things. You know, I think I'm so wealthy. I think you know, getting back together was a lot of talking with these guys, and you know, I know how crazy it was round one, and it was fun, but it was hell as well. Like, it just got to a point where you wanted to get off the bus. The bus was just figuratively, but we weren't on the bus. And it wasn't fun, and I walked away. And, you know, that always haunts me, that I left these guys. And then here's an opportunity to get back together, and I was still not really sure, you know. I hadn't come out publicly yet, and that was always on my mind. I didn't even tell these guys. Like, that shot of us in the studio, I think that's when we first, like, started talking about it, you know? Hey, John's gay, pass the letter.
I think we already knew John, but we're just waiting for you to catch up.
That is true. I was telling a story yesterday in the night. I was in a hotel room with my current boyfriend. We are butt naked under the covers. Donnie comes walking in the room with Flavor Flav.
I was there too. I was there.
And these fools jump on the bed and just start jumping around with me and this naked boyfriend.
I remember it. That's what I learned. You waited 18 years to tell me, but I figured it out that day.
I knew before that.
Yeah. But no, that was such a great memory. We were in a hotel in LA.
It was a poignant moment for me because, you know, I was a huge Public Enemy fan, and it didn't sway my opinion of anything, but someone came up to my room and said, Flavor Flav's in the lobby and he's looking for you. And I went downstairs and he was like, Donnie! We hugged and he went crazy and he met my mom and he was like, Mom's one! And Dan Lippo said, I want to see all the other guys. We had met him a few times before. He knew I was a huge fan.
Okay. Just a quick story. So we went up the elevator looking for everyone. We found Jordan, we found Joey, and we went to John's room, and it was, they changed the rules in the hotels. The housekeeper was right outside. We said, can you let us in the room? And she said, okay. So we walked in, it was like 2 p.m, and they were under the covers, and I didn't think nothing of it, but what was really wonderful was Flavor Flav was like, what's up, John? And jumped on the bed. We jumped on the bed. It was like, it was so wonderful and normal. There was nothing out of the ordinary. In our hearts and in our minds, it was like, all right, this is what it is. Okay. And Flavor Flav was the same way. It was like, it was so, like,
nothing. Like, we didn't walk out the door and go, what was going on in there? Were they cold or were they doing it?
My brother was in my room.
Oh, shit.
And we were sleeping in the same bed. And so we got to be in the same experience. Like, holy shit, you guys jumped on our bed. And my brother, of course, loved it. He was like laughing crazy, whatever. But I wonder if it was like, you know, that was part of it too. But I understand. I mean, we slept in the same room
all the time.
So it wasn't that out of the ordinary.
No, well, I thought the same thing. I literally had Jimmy Marsh and Dana, the Northside boys from back then, they were on tour with me, and we all slept in the same bed. Like, it was like, okay. We just kept our clothes on. That was the only difference.
These great producers, and you know, you mentioned Lady Gaga. How did this environment come about where you were being, you know, so generous with bringing other people in, being inspired by them, allowing them to creatively work with you? Was that just organic, or did you actively go out and search for those people?
I think it just started to come together. Word started to get around that the New Kids were back. Like you had said, it was a bubble. The bubble started expanding, and producers started to reach out. So Red One was someone who reached out, and had really only done a lot of hip hop records at that point, but he could play like 10 instruments. He's a genius musician. And you know, that sort of opened another creative door. And it started where I think Nasri and I started working with Red One, and then Red One and I really developed a really close bond, and it kind of became him and I. And I think starting working with Nasri gave me confidence as a songwriter again, that eventually he started to do other things, and I was like, okay, I'm gonna keep going with Red One here and keep writing. And Red One, I think one night, and producers came from other places. Joey had a friend named E-Man, who most of you guys know. And he was like, can you go write with E-Man tomorrow? And I was like, yep, I'll go. And he was like, give him a chance, he's great. And I went and did a session with him, which is where 2 in the Morning came from. We wrote that song with him and Casey Livingston. And the next day or a week later, we had to record it. And so we had to do 2 sessions at one time in the same building. So we were recording 2 in the Morning in one room with E-Man. And down the hall, we were writing Big Girl Now with Red One. And it was a really cool time because we would walk down the hallway and there was Usher, who was recording in another studio. And like all these superstars were coming through and they were all excited to see us. And we were excited to see them. And the magic just started to flow. It just started to become a thing where all these, you know, collecting thoughts and ideas and meeting with people just started to produce all these opportunities. And from working with Red One, he would always, one of the ways he would introduce himself to us and to get us familiar with his sound was he would play Lady Gaga. And her music was phenomenal. And it was like, oh my God, this is great. And then Joey had seen her somewhere and he was like, I saw that Lady Gaga at the Grove or something.
Oh yeah,
and he was like,
yeah,
she's a star. She's a star.
Oh my goodness, she came in. It was just a regular restaurant, and she had gold leggings on, like sparkly, like unbelievable, as if she was on stage, you know. And no one knew who she was, but she was with Red One,
And so we. Jordan and I were singing 2 in the Morning and writing Big Girl Now. Jordan demoed all the Gaga parts, so more about that later. But it was an amazing demo of me and Jordan being New Kids in Gaga. When we recorded, we wrote Big Girl Now, we thought, let's make it a duet. And we were like, we have to get a female singer to sing it. And we were like, we'll get Britney, we'll get Christina Aguilera. Everyone's so excited, we're reunited. And Red One suggested having Gaga demo it and just do a reference vocal for whatever female artist was gonna sing it. And she sang it. and we knew. We were all in the studio together.
That's the imitation I would do with her.
We were in the studio, and we knew right there. We were like, we don't want any other artist on this song. We want Lady Gaga on this song. And we had already discussed her opening for us on tour, and you know, it was something that I think Red One and I bonded over. It was like, you know, please help her get the opening spot on your tour. And I was like, we will. And as we went on, when she sang that part on the record, she slayed it. I mean, she killed it. And it was like, doesn't matter if nobody knows her, if nobody ever knows her, if this is her record. And it made it easier to bring her on tour. But one of the amazing moments that came from that is when we did those sessions with her, she asked at the end of recording Big Girl Now if I would write with her. And I was like, heck yeah. I mean, I'd heard her out. I knew she was great. But I said, we're coming tomorrow. Can you come back? And she was like, yeah. And she came back. In that following session, we wrote Full Service together. We had talked, I think all of us had talked about, we were starting to duet with people. We were starting to expand, and we were getting songs with other people. And it was like, we really had sort of mentioned doing a song on New Edition. And there was no song that was right for it. There wasn't anything that was the song. But when we started writing Full Service, I was like, this could be the song. This could really be it. So while we were in the middle of writing, I called Johnny Gill, who is a dear friend. And I said, where are you? He said, I just landed at Burbank Airport. I said, can you come over? And he came over immediately, sang the demo, and that led to us and New Edition recording, I think it's safe to say, the dream song for everyone in the band, a song with our idols, New Edition.
What was it like being in the studio with Gaga? I mean, we have to imagine who she was back then, but you can see it. I mean, could you tell that she was going to become like one of the biggest stars on the planet?
Well, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I remember Gaga walking in, like when we would have dance rehearsals and stuff. I didn't even know who she was, but she just walked by and I'm like, I thought she was already like this huge star. But I mean, her coming on tour with us, like her work ethic was crazy. She would do shows with us, and then after the show, she'd go to like 3 nightclubs. Like she'd be out to like 2-3 in the morning, just, you know, going. It kind of reminded like what we did back in the day. You know, you really gotta hustle. And then when her first single, Just Dance, yeah. That one. You know, when that came out, I was like, she's going places. It took a little, like, she always dressed weird and like weird things. So
she didn't have any money, you know, so she was making her own clothes, you know. So they had that vibe about it, but yeah. she'd have like a hood on and glasses.
She was like the superhero in those
movies.
You'd
just be having coffee and she'd walk in.
They have like the cheap outfits on and then they become big and then they get the really cool outfits.
Yeah.
But like what Joe was saying, she would come into the studio and yeah, she had an aura for sure. When you see her now, she's always over the top. But even then, she was just a creative person. I'd be like, where'd you get that tie? Or where'd you get this? Or that hat? She goes, oh, I made it. Like, she was, like, into all of that fashion and the clothes all on her own. So it definitely was a very... It's not like she met a stylist and a stylist made her. She was her. She made herself.
Yeah. I still remember that vocal. You know, the vocal we hear on Big Girl Now is like, you know... She just had it, you know what I mean? I still remember it, like, hearing it in the studio, her recording it. And that's why I always say I hope she does more, like, R&B like that, because she does it all, and I know she can do opera and everything, but, like,
mean, for someone who was like so in the zone, mostly off her first album, like that sound. I mean, it was very cool to like, you know, it was special. You know what I mean?
Joe, I'm really wanting you to do the dance that she did at the recording board.
Well, she was just like right in, but like she would stand there like in front of the board. Every time, she couldn't help herself. She couldn't help herself. Maybe she came.
That's great. It's done. How do you know, like, it's ready to be released to us?
When it's like being printed. We learned an interesting thing about how the music business changed since we were kids, and now making an album ourselves as adults. So we thought we were getting pretty close, and the way the industry kind of worked, at least in 08, I don't know what it does now. We do new kids, you know. We're here at Blockcon. We won't make a song, we put it out for you guys. It's like we have our own thing. I don't consider us part of the industry. We're in the blockhead business, and that's it. Like, this is all we're for you guys. But producers, there's only so many people at that time in 2008 that could get played on the radio. And now it's probably even smaller, right? There's like 10 artists. You'd always hear a certain artist over and over again. And then there's like a 10 artists maybe. But the producers, the top producers, grab their best songs and save it. And when they think that what they'll do is we would get a lot of demos from people, and it'd be like, wait, who's singing this demo? And they'd be like, oh, Pussycat Dolls, but don't worry about that. What happened was Pussycat Dolls recorded it, and then they didn't want it. And the producer's like, you take it. You know, they're trying to place their songs, right? So, but when a producer gets over, although we did do one of those, Lights, Camera, Action, was first recorded for the Pussycat Dolls, but it was meant for us, so that worked out great. But, The top producers, if they find a gem, they hold it, right? And they sort of wait, and they wait till the album of the artist they're looking at is almost done. And at the end, right when you think you're done, it's like, all right, album's done. And they go, no, it's not. Here comes Timbaland with a song, or here comes Teddy Riley with a song. And that started happening. And the problem was the songs were great. So we were close to the finish line, and Joe and I went to a basketball game. We were going to the Celtics and Lakers championship game in 2008, sorry. And Jimmy Iovine from Interscope Records, I had signed Marky Mark to Interscope Records in 1991 and produced their first number one song that label ever had, a Good Vibration. So Jimmy and I reconnected when we felt we had enough music to get the album going, to get an album deal. And so the Celtics were the championship, and I didn't have tickets in LA, so I called Jimmy. I said, hey, I need your Laker tickets to go to see the Celtics tonight. So Joey and I hopped in a limo with the producer, Polo the Don. And Polo was produced Usher and all these huge hit records. And he kept playing this record in the car. And like, we're close to the finish line of the album. And it was like, he played it, and he played it, and he played it, and it was this song by Neo. And we're like, but we're talking, he's not, you know, we don't know what's going on. He's just playing it. And yeah, so what do you guys been up to? And where do you want to go to eat after the game? Played it again. And I don't know how it came to be, but a week later, Joey called me and was like, hey, I just heard Jimmy Iovine wants us to do Single. And I was like, that song in the car that Polo kept playing over and over, the Neo record? He was like, yeah, I'm going to sing it now. And we went and did it. And so the album extended, and that became a process. That whole recording of that song was a process.
And to piggyback on, you know, Jimmy Iovine and Donnie's relationship with Jimmy Iovine and Jordan's relationship with Jimmy Iovine and for his solo album. But, you know, Jimmy Iovine's, you know, for those of you who don't know, he's a legend in the music business, you know, as far as, you know, I think he started, like, engineering Beatles records. And so, I mean, he's a legend. And that, having that kind of a guy can slow things up too, right?
Yeah.
Because, and Donnie's so
good. Need the right, just one more song.
Yeah.
We're missing one.
Right. And I'm the kind of guy banging your head off the wall like, I'm done, we're done, let's go, you know? And you have to juggle that. And of course we did. And, you know, to your point, like Teddy Riley, all these great people, you know, those and talk about songwriting and all this stuff, you know, seeing that and enjoying you, like, you hadn't been in the studio in, what, 15 years or something, like, writing? So it was just, like, all that energy and all that focus was great to watch. And you know, frankly, I'm glad, because I wrote music, too, but, like, talking about the dynamics of the group, I feel it was heaven sent that I didn't feel the need to write, you know what I mean? Because that can stop up the flow of it too, you know what I mean? But what I was focused on was singing as much shit as I could get my hands on. When you got Jordan Knight and Donnie Wahlberg and these other guys in the group, you gotta grind sometimes. And that was one of the songs. And it was single, and I think I called, it's not like I knew, but like I was literally in the car at 10:30 at night driving to the studio, like, I'm going now, you know? And it was the Neo song, it was single, and I went in there, and luckily Adam, I mean, that was a clue too. We had been working with Adam Nasri's partner, so they let him record the vocals, which is, that's little things that are important to do, because we had a comfort level already with him, and it's like, let's go. And I went in there, and like, yo, you're like, you gave him one of those, like, you're like, yo, and I was like, so that's what I remember about that song. And then you went in and sang the chorus and you killed the chorus, and then Jay finished it off, and for a second it was gonna be, we thought it just might be our record,
right?
But the backstory, we're gonna talk about that, that all the while, like,
Neo was not happy about this. He didn't know anything about this. It's okay, Jordan. We'll be here. we do need bathroom breaks sometimes. Neo, Jimmy Iovine called and said, hey, Neo wants his record back. Like, didn't you talk to him about this in the first place? And he was like, well, kind of, not really. So I called Neo, and he was a gem. He was just amazing about everything. He said, you guys sound great. I love it, but I want my song. And I knew, like, I can move on from off of things quickly. You know, I'll just like, okay, this door closes, I'm going in the next door. So I knew I could live without the song, even though it was amazing. And we, like, the next day after we recorded, we were doing a photo shoot. We played it for 10 hours straight. Like, we were obsessed with the song. But I was facing the reality that it might go away. So I was like, okay, well, I can maybe get over losing it, but Joey won't. So I called Neo, and we talked it out, and he was like, can we make it a duet? And I was like, that would be an honor for us to share it with you. He said, okay, but on my album, it's going to be just me. So if you ever heard the version of Neo on the radio, just him, that's why. It was his, like Joey, his favorite song on the block, single. Neo's favorite song on his album was single. And that level of passion from both of these men about that song left me to try to mediate, to save it for all of us. And Neo was so gracious, and we hung up the phone, and it was a done deal. He was like, I'm in, I'll do a video with you guys. Let's take it the full nine and go with it. We had worked with him on Face the Music. Teddy Riley was really one of the driving forces for us on Face the Music. Phenomenal producer, all-time iconic producer. And we jumped in and did Grown Man. And that was basically mostly him and I just knocking it out. And then right, we were master mixing the album. It's the final thing you do. When you do that, you send the tape or the, whatever it is to the plant, and they're printing CDs. It's over. And out of nowhere, they said, Timbaland called and has a song. And we actually got two songs from him, and one of them was called Back Together. And it was like, this is the perfect final song. This is what we all waited for, that one that the smart producer held to the end, and so he could make it be our single. And he was like, yeah, you can't have that one. And we're like, and he was like, but I got this other one. It's called Twisted. So we decided to go to Florida. It was Jordan and me and Joey, and Danny lived there, obviously. And we all had a different agenda. So I went down there to say, okay, we're going to sing Twisted, but I'm going to get Back Together. Like, I'm gonna try to get him to give us that record. And I was like, Jordan, you got to help me talk to Timbaland. And the first night Jordan was there, Timbaland came in and wrote a whole new song, which he ended up doing for Chris Cornell, called Stop Me. So I was like, Jordan, what happened last night? He was like, we didn't do shit. He just came in and wrote a new song, and we should do that song. And I was like, oh shit, well now we gotta try to negotiate two songs. And Joey very wisely was like, you two go in the other room and negotiate. I'm gonna go sing Twisted and have a ball. And he did.
You know, what is this song?
It's different.
And so, you know, you guys ended up doing the verse, but I did have to, like, do a whole other cast. I tried to, in my mind, like, sing it like Green Day, which might not make any sense, but, like, sometimes you go, what the hell is this song? You know, it's just so, I just went at it, and Fauntleroy, that's his last name, right?
James
Fauntleroy, who is done a bunch of records, was doing the vocal, and he was a character. So sometimes you just have to connect with who's behind the board, and you can get something going. But
all I remember was Timbaland was mad as shit. he was upset.
After we did it, right?
I think because we were telling him, well, Jimmy told us that we could do this song, and he was just fuming in the studio.
That was his baby. He... you know, the way you are, I don't know the cars and the car keys, baby, I love you, just the... That was his big hit. And this song, Back Together, had that feeling.
Yeah.
It sounded like the follow-up.
It sounded like a typical Timbaland.
It was a smasheroni. And we were like, come on, let it... He was, in his mind, he was like, no, that's my baby. That's Joey's single. That's Neo's single. You're not recording that. That's my record. And he probably wasn't happy that told us to get out there and we could record it.
He was like,
it wasn't mad at us, though.
Right. He was mad at the situation that he was put in.
Yep. And if I can, he was right. Twisted was the song.
Totally.
For us.
Absolutely.
You know, it was the right song. Since it's the 15th anniversary of the Block album this fall, five of us will be gathering all of that magical material and digging into those archives and reissuing the Block album in its full... Conversations happening. We worked out a situation with Universal Music, and it's just, we're super excited, and going back and diving into the archives of that album is incredible. It's much like, you know, 1988 was this magical, emotional time in our lives that we all shared earlier, and 2008 was the rebirth or the reconnecting, right, of those times. And it does give the feels the way that maybe the Hangin' Tough 30th anniversary did, except we had control of all the materials, so we still have it all. And we can make this a reissued album unlike any other. And I can't wait to we can share it.
Like a childhood crush, you know, we loved you, we were part, you were part of our lives, but it feels like this very innocent part, and now I feel like we're so connected to all of you as adults, as friends, as fans, and the way that you have given so much to us.
Do we have a... There is a clip somewhere in one of our little documentaries of Joey doing, we were somewhere in New York and Joey said, we had this planned all along. Our fans who were little kids were gonna grow up and infiltrate everything, and now they run the offices and they're lawyers and they're this, and here it is right here. Sonal is a true blockhead from day one. I did a Twitter contest in New York one time where I saw a painting of a matador and I said, that looks like John. And I did a scavenger hunt, find me in the next hour. If you find this painting, you'll find me. One blockhead found me, it was Sonal.
I raced out of my office and ran down the avenue to reach this restaurant.
She knew the painting.
I knew the painting, and I walked in, and there was a painting of John Knight in all his matador. And I was like, this is the place. And I turned around, there you were. And that was the beginning.
It was.
So thank you.
And we're so honored that you did this for us. And so thankful to all of you. I guess we're going to take a break for just a few minutes and come back for some fun. Okay, we'll be right back.
All right, don't yell at me in front of thousands of people. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the final panel of the night, the talk panel with New Kids on the Block. Come on out. Have a good time and keep it light. Shirts on. Okay.
We'll see.
It's okay. You can, you're fine. We don't need it. We can Google that. Right? We can Google that. So the first game we're going to play is called Block It Out.
Block It Out?
Yes. Sorry for my Chicago accent. Block It Out.
Okay.
This is a pretty easy game. Basically, Zach and I scoured the internet. We made a few phone calls. And we found, oh yeah, and we found some clips that maybe you've never seen of the New Kids on the Block. And actually, maybe you guys have never seen them.
We're about to find out.
We're about to find out. We're going to show a clip. This is how it works. We're going to show a clip, and you guys have to tell us, do you remember the moment, or did you block it out? How do you feel? Good?
John said I blocked everything.
All right, you ready? First clip.
All the way from Boston, Mass, the one and only New Kids on the Block.
Thank you.
the fuck?
Boston, get ready for what?
Those Jordan.
Did we just... suits.
I didn't know they were two were red and two three were black. I thought they were all black.
Skip this, skip them. Skip it a little.
Oh my god.
Nine lands down, right? For giants.
Did we just escape? Were we all like in a mental institution? And we just escaped? Took off our robes and stuff? And set us free.
So you remember?
I don't know. Some of us do, and John clearly blocked it out. John, no clue?
Did we have shower caps on?
I know what it was. Go ahead.
I don't know. What was the game?
I know. I'm going to take a little credit for this one.
Is it raining out?
No. We got rare opportunities to perform, and sometimes we got asked to perform at themed things. And we would do things according to the theme to sort of fit in with it. It was really not necessary, but I was overthinking it a little bit.
So if it was, what was the theme
it
for
was
that?
Nine Lands Down Street. So we used to play quite frequently at a over 21 club, and none of us were even close to 21. So we were actually breaking the law being in there. But that was it was called the Pajama Party for the only radio station in Boston that would play our record at the time, and they had a pajama party. So of course, I was like, guys, let's go out in pajamas. Let's wear robes and cats and teddy bears. And Danny, you look like you tried to kill someone with your... Did you see him throw the shower cap?
Why am I so angry, man? What's going on?
It looked like we were like disguised as old ladies just getting out of the shower so we could get into the overage club or something like that.
I guess we couldn't really afford the pajamas. I don't know. We went with robes and shower caps.
Early 88, because it was the right stuff, and it was, we were the new kids on the block, so that was early 88. But that was, did we get those suits at Fields Corner? We got everything.
Probably, yeah.
But those
Mike John.
Yeah. Brand new Jordans,
yeah,
Michael and Jordan. The suits.
Yeah.
We wore those suits at the Boston Music Awards. I think we did it at the Jack the Ripper convention, too.
Jack the Rapper, yeah.
Jack the Rapper. It's one vowel.
They both kill, I assume. You ready for the next clip?
Yeah. So far, we all remember except for John.
Okay. All right, the next clip, do you remember it? Or did you block it out, not including John?
A friend of ours, Al McQuaid, he was shot recently. And we just want everyone to know that this world can be a better place if each and every one of us take a second and stop the violence. So now that that's out of the way, let's put it to a more positive note and get busy. Can I have some music, please?
I know who this is.
That's Crystal in the front, at the bottom, the girl that pierced my nose.
Yeah.
Were we doing like an outdoor aerobics exercise? Teaching a class?
Boston Common. Boston
was
Common.
It?
Yes. It was right before we went on tour with Tiffany because we would just, it was, yeah, in Boston. We were,
there was more than eight people in the audience.
Yeah.
It started, we have a dear friend from Boston named Al McLean. Al got shot? said at the beginning.
Oh, yeah, he got shot, yeah.
God, not Jesus. I blocked that out. I talk to him all the time. He was a professional basketball player, and we text every Celtics game. We text. He's like, geez, they gotta bench this guy. They gotta get rid of the coach. He always has basketball opinions. We talk every day. I didn't know he got shot. He did.
You blocked it out.
I blocked it out.
What part of his body did he get shot?
I don't know.
I don't remember, but was he at the hospital at that time? I remember going, I think I went to the hospital to see him. But it wasn't, like, he didn't get shot by that.
He got a light shooting. It's a gentle shooting.
We remember some of it, and some of it we blocked out.
Yes.
I mean, and people, to this day, they go, and then they went out into the crowd. Like, no one ever does. Like, it's the greatest thing ever in the history of anything that a band goes out into the crowd. But we always do it.
Here it is, countdown. Here's the watch of our very special guest, New Kid on the Block. Hi there.
Hi.
Okay, now, where shall I start? Y'all play instruments, or do you just sing, or what?
We play a little bit. Donnie plays drums, and Jordan plays keyboards, and I try and play keyboards.
We're a multifaceted group. We do a lot.
What's she doing there?
She's giving me a wedgie. Rap.
Could you do some ad-lib rap right here?
Yes. Check it out. On the 1, 2, 3, I'm in the place to be in Holland. Yes, on the MIC. It's Donnie D, Danny D, Jordan K, Joey Joe. In the place to be with John on this show. Huh.
It looked like
you liked it.
I think I did.
I agree, though. It could have went a whole different way.
Where was that in
Holland?
Latin America? Holland?
He said Holland, yeah. He said, welcome to Holland.
Oh, from behind you look like someone from Menudo.
Holland in the house, we got some fans. Let's go, Max. Tomorrow, let's go. He called us New Kid on the Block. I have to admit, I had blocked this out.
Okay.
I had blocked it out. Someone posted it on Instagram a few weeks ago, though. I don't know who it was, if they're here. So I did see it. You did it? You posted it. Did I repost it? Oh, yeah. I did see it, so I have to recuse myself from this.
Is it a big deal if we just one more just freeze on them? Can I see that again? Because
Pam, can you play it again?
It's all coming back to me. You don't need the sound, but
pause it.
That I was wearing that.
Your personal rock show with
no sound.
Yeah. So see this outfit? See this? Okay, this is an iconic poster. Of us on the stairwell, and in these outfits.
Pause.
These are the outfits, and we're like one's on the side. I think I'm on the side, and we're all in these outfits. And that was a big poster.
So we must have did it that day.
I think I'm like this, pretending I'm like Danny Reagan or coming around the corner.
We did it that day. Hulk was a lot of fun. I was wearing those jeans and that thing, and everybody else was wearing. I recognize it all, and. So I didn't block out the poster, but
and John is so well dressed in the back.
Yeah, yes,
cleans up nice.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
All right, let's do one more. Jesus, do you remember this, or did you block it out? I have to keep the hook going.
Open up, please.
starting to remember things. I remember flying to Japan, and it was just like the longest flight. It's like opposite. And they came out with these clothes, and
it's
I know I did. Did you guys were all like, what the hell is this? What
really?
You like those clothes?
I think at first we were like, what is this? But then we kind of just embraced it and went with it to have fun with it because it was supposedly only going to be seen in Japan.
Till tonight.
So I remember I had a blast on that because we were just having fun and like it felt, you know, like years before that, like just have fun with it, go with it. But yeah, we walked up and the clothes looked crazy, but we just embraced it.
We were lamping. I think that's what you call lamping back in the day. Buck Hill.
And edgy and great and, yeah. They, what? Play it again?
Yeah. Someone likes a leather capri.
None of us blocked it out, but okay. We can watch it again if you want. You can talk the block with the Dodi Kahan. Born in the sound, the soul, the sound. The Dodi Kahan. Whoopers, bars, tweeters, twitches, four has to get more power than this. Finally, you, the truth, the new age born. The Dodi Kahan. Dodi Kahan.
One more? All right. Do you remember or do you block it out?
You're obviously aware of the fact that what you're writing is crap. And that's your opinion. That's that, right?
You don't think it's crap.
I didn't say everyone in the room. I'm talking about the particular articles that I remember seeing your face with a big smiley face like this. Right next to it. Saying, you give Google so we can do that and you can put a big smile right next to it. That's what I'm talking about. And now you're not talking about it. All right,
thank you. We always say that. We work hard, we care about music, we're five kids from Boston.
The mission statement.
It was in Rio. I did not block that out. Rock and Rio Festival.
Pierce Morgan?
Yeah, so, yeah. Well, Pierce Morgan asked a question. I have to say, when we did the Boston Strong concert, I'm back, I'm going in reverse. I'm reverse engineering the story. The Boston Strong concert, he interviewed me for the Boston Strong concert after the Boston Marathon bombing, and we buried the hatchet. But back then, we were late for that press conference. We didn't know. We were just going where we were told to go. They said, go down to a press conference. So we walked in, and everyone booed us. All the media people booed us, and I got a little upset, and I think we all got upset. And slowly, we were fighting back, and a couple of people in the room were clapping, and Piers Morgan got up, and he asked something about how do you guys feel about all the negative stories written about you, and, you know, what do you have to say about them? And I wasn't sure who he was. I just remembered his face, and I thought I remembered it next to a salacious headline about us, like this. And so I just took a leap of faith and said, basically, how do you feel having the nerve to ask that question when you're the guy that's writing half of those false and salacious stories about us? And it turned into a feud that lasted a while.
When we were in London, you would go back. Didn't you wear a t-shirt that said Pierce Sucks or something like that?
I did.
Yeah.
I did at Wembley Arena.
Very rock and roll.
It was very rock and roll, and
yeah.
It went on for a while, and
Yeah.
Kept the headlines going, that's for sure. I mean, not that death was your intention, but I don't remember that at all. See, that was like,
little Joey wants to go away from all the bad stuff. Mommy and Daddy are arguing. Time to leave.
Donnie, Jordan, and Danny were like, stand behind us, Joey, we'll handle this. It was that time of, you know, sometimes fighting back wasn't always the right thing to do, but at that time it was, because it's why I'm here now the way we are. And, you know, I wouldn't do that now unless it was really necessary, but, you know, just... Good memories. It was fun at that moment, though, to be right and to catch him and to stand up for ourselves. And the best part was the whole room full of worldwide media after I did that. Apparently, they had some form of relationship with him, and they all started cheering for us for the rest of the press conference. So it went from boos to cheers, thanks to Peters.
Yes. I see everything. So we're going to move on to another fun game, but I need all of you to not look at the screen. Is that cool? So stare into the eyes of the audience.
Kids. They can stare.
They can. Don't you stay here. Look at us. Look at the screen. We're going to do something called Then and Now. So like any good New Kid fan in the 80s, like you read the Tiger Beats. You read the Bops. Right? Like, right? Because you wanted to know everything. Are they single? Do they love me? Do they like brunettes? Right? So we thought it would be fun if we found some of those old interview questions and asked you if you remember what you said.
Jordan likes ketchup on his eggs.
Okay. Are we just remembering?
Don't get ahead of the game.
Are we remembering what we said or what?
Yeah, remember what you said.
And what your answer would be now.
Yes. Ah. So we're going to tell you if you're right, because the answers are great. They're hard hitting. Are you ready for the game?
Yes.
Zach, kick it off.
Okay, first up, Donnie, do you remember what was your favorite color?
It changed all the time. What? You can say it.
That's the answer.
I remember sometimes you would say plaid.
And purple and black and gold, because I'm a Leo. So I gotta guess which answer I gave at some time during the course of all the magazines.
Yes.
I know I didn't like to commit to answers. I was like, I don't know. Depends. I don't know.
The answer is Dixie Depends.
Well, not Celtic green, of course. That's the color of my blood. And blockhead blue is the color of my heart. I would say gold. Gold is my favorite color.
Look at my freaking mood! Like a good mood ring.
Yeah.
All right, Jordan, do you remember what your favorite color was? It was either blue or red. What year was this? A long time ago.
The 80s.
I'm going to go with red. So close. It was baby blue. See, that's why I wanted to know what year it was. Baby blue. What's your favorite color now? Today? But probably red. Red's my favorite. Joey, favorite color. Back in the day?
Back in the day.
I think once I said red, white, and blue. That's it. Red, white, and blue. Very patriotic.
Yes.
And what's your favorite color now? Like a nice earthy gray.
What a change.
that. It's nice neutral.
Plot twist.
Yeah. John, do you remember your favorite color?
I'd have to say it's blue.
It was black and white.
from the colorblind guy.
Black and white. So then it was black and white. Now would you say it's a rainbow?
I like a rainbow. I think my favorite color now is green. Yeah, I like this theme.
Great. All right, Danny. You're up.
Oh, man. I'm black? Wrong.
It was blue. And what's your favorite color now?
I don't really have one. I just wear whatever. I'm not a favorites person. Like, I think, like, you guys ask us, what's your favorite song to perform? And I would list too many. Like, it's, I'm not really a favorite person.
The correct answer is green.
Green?
All right, we're going to go to our next question.
It's either going to be like lasagna or Italian. Hot dogs, pizza. Cheeseburgers?
Chinese.
Dorchester, baby.
He was so shocked he dropped
the
ball. Oh, what was that? What was that place at the end of our street?
China Pagoda.
China Pagoda.
That was the spot.
That's probably what did it. Okay.
The spot.
What's your favorite food today?
I don't have one. I just like, I like basic food. Just like, give me a cheeseburger, give me some pizza, whatever. Lasagna,
Twix.
Do you still do this? Actually, I haven't seen you do this in a long time. When you eat, you go.
What?
You know you do that? If you're having some pizza or something, you take a bite.
You take it and you go. That's because I never have a napkin. That's how I get this shit off me.
It's part of your, when you get into the pool.
I'm not really a foodie. Just regular, normal food.
Hey, you said prejudice.
Cool. Who is that, John? Is John somebody?
He said prejudice as well.
Okay.
What is it now?
Good answer. What is it now? This, like, at this moment, is these really dirty fingernails. Angela tried to get me to a manicurist earlier, and I said, no, these are just working man hands.
Different, said something different, but I'm gonna go with prejudice.
No. Do you guys want to shout out what he said?
What? What?
What? What? What?
War.
War? Like war sucks? That makes sense. Yeah, I didn't like war either. I still don't.
Is that your answer for what it is today?
Well, I still don't, but I don't know if that would be my main dislike. Prejudice. That would be my better answer now.
Oh, shit.
It was long?
Yes.
Very detailed. Soliloquy? I honestly thought I would, like, I wrote something like, just like, war. Okay. So it was a long answer. It's not specific?
Yes.
Don't give it away.
Okay, I'm not charades.
That's nice.
People who buy books. This is very deep thoughts. People who are assholes.
It's all basketball teams except the Celtics.
Or same thing. Okay, I remember that. Yeah.
What is it now? Asshole still? Or?
I think now, people, what I don't like, what don't you? Lower back pain. Not caused by sex. Hey, you didn't ask us what sign we were back then.
I just saw that. What an idiot. Here's how we're going to do it. Underneath your seats, there are 5 paddles with all your faces on them. So grab those bad boys. Here's the thing. We've seen this game before from you guys, but we know one of you was not there. Danny, baby, you're missing during this one. So we're going to redo it and re-upped the questions.
Oh, we did this in an interview before.
You did, yeah. But
I remember that.
Yeah.
You weren't there.
You weren't there.
This isn't going to break the group up, is it?
No.
We're about to find out. We just did the reunion panel.
So yeah. I think we're pretty good at
it'll be recorded, so we'll see how it all goes down. Okay, we're going to ask you a question. Just put up the face that you think it applies.
Just to ensure that we don't break up, can we go all on one couch?
I would love that.
It's easier to see the answers. Come on, John.
This would be an awesome time to leave the group if you were going to leave the group.
You know what? This side's not going to be able to see. Do you want to
cut really make a splash?
No, we're here. We're good.
Oh, you're on the screen, Dad.
We're all on the screen.
Sorry, ladies.
Whose hips got bigger? Sorry.
That reminds me of car rides back in the day.
All right, you ready?
I have a lot back there, John. Deal with it.
First question. Who has the most shoes?
Shoes.
You can't play.
Dennis Cheese.
What did you think it said?
Someday.
Hold on. You have sneakers. Let's specify. Sneakers.
Well, they're the same though, right?
Well, shoes is a different topic. I don't have those. Shoes, I'm gonna go.
Shoes?
If he had clean fingernails, Junior, I'd say John. Sure. His fingernails are dirty, so I'm gonna say Jordan.
I mean, this is up for debate. Yeah, I mean, I would probably shoot. I mean, sort of, not really.
Joe has shoes.
I wear the same shit every day. Okay.
All right.
Sneakers, Donnie. Shoes, Joe.
Sneakers. All right.
All right.
That's it?
That's all. We're going to go now.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. There's no answer?
It's all your answer.
Oh.
Yeah. It's just to reveal how you're feeling. Okay.
The questions get spicier as we go.
Here we go. Who takes the longest to get ready?
Because it's more of an OCD thing. Because I'm always like forgetting things, or I run back to the dressing room to like move my phone over 3 feet. And then I run back and I move it back 2 feet, and then I'm ready.
All right.
I honor that process.
Okay, who tells the longest stories?
It's not fair. It's not fair. They've all listened to it happen all day.
Nobody digresses like Don, you know. It's the best. He always brings you back to the point.
It tells a good story.
I try.
All right, I'm going to jump to one I really want to know, and I think we will too. Which new kid fling the world never knew about?
John said John. John said John, so I'm going with John.
Oh, you just want to know.
What if it was one of us? That was the celebrity fling. Like, what if it was one of us behind the bush with John? Can we put both faces up?
Put both faces up if that's what happened to you.
John, who was it?
I had a little short romance with Princess of Monaco.
What?
Yes. It was very brief.
Was she gay at the time, too? Oh, so it worked out. What constitutes a fling?
That's really your journey. What do you think of flinging? Did you ever commit? Like, did you ever say, we're boyfriend, girlfriend, boyfriend, boyfriend?
Oh. As long as it happened in the bushes?
Yeah.
I guess you're right. A bush fling does check out.
All right.
I feel like you... Yeah, Danny...
The world knew. People knew.
Danny stayed the princess of Monaco as well.
And then Donnie took her to prom.
You guys are fast. You guys are fast. Okay.
All right.
Next one. Who farts the most in the green room? In the green room.
Come on. I don't have a Nick Carter face here.
People don't know my stealth, y'all.
See?
I'm stealthy.
See, the Knight Brothers?
Yeah, the most.
Danny and Donnie fart like dog farts. Like you know. Smells like the Knight Brothers cat fart.
Yeah.
It's like they just walk in the room and just go like.
They just.
You don't know what happened.
Oh no. And these days, y'all, it just falls out. You can't even help it. It's just, what the fuck?
Hey, yo.
Another one? God damn.
Okay, we're gonna do one last one. Unless you want to marinate on that part.
There's a private part.
This is an open vent, y'all. Open vent.
I mean, you sit down for more than 20 minutes, you know. You get up for anything. It's just coming, yeah. Doorbell rings.
Shit. For a guy who doesn't say a lot, you sure said a whole lot.
TMI.
No, they sneak out. You all right?
Okay, here's the last one.
I was like... Rockets.
Any sudden movements. It's like, oh, shit.
Oh. Yeah. What that asshole say? He's talking shit behind your back.
Be a full meal. All right. Here's a question. The last question. If you could change places with any of your bandmates for one day and be them, like live their life, who would it be? I know we got deep up in this piece, right off of Ferns.
First thing I think about, oh, that's a tough one. Oh, we should just say it. John's killing it. John is living the life.
Thank you, guys.
And we want to be.
I want to know the joy. Because I see John, he works all day. He's got dirt all over his hands. He can't wash it off. Anyhow, I want to know the pure joy that John gets every day, because he's out planting, building, and it seems it's such a cool, simple life, and he loves it so much, and it's not simple. He puts his heart and soul into it. He's like, he'll come home, he'll be like, I got these new seeds from the plant store. I can't wait to plant these tomorrow. And it seems like such a cool life. Yeah.
Andy, why'd you pick John?
Probably like the same reasons. He's at home, he seems so happy, and very productive, works really hard, but enjoys it, so it's, that's the best job, is like our job right now, but a job like that too that you love, so.
Same answer for both of you.
No, I would say one, because Harley is very hot.
Finally, we get real.
And two, honestly, I don't even know how to like hang a picture on a wall. Like, if I got a screw, would it...
Go on.
If I need to screw something in, I don't know how to say this the right way.
Try nails.
Put it this way. If I buy something from IKEA that requires me to turn a thing, I'm not doing it. I'm getting a hammer and smacking the screw into the thing. I'm so incompetent. Jenny is like building shit. Jenny's like John in our house. And I'm like, I don't know what. Very not handy in that format with my hands. Thank you.
What about you, Sam?
Yeah, I'm a big fan. Big fan. I always say I just want to be like just. It's. I'm trying to say the right words that is not somehow a sexual innuendo with this crowd.
You're going to be his little assistant.
I wanted to say like a laborer. You would call it a laborer. But that, they'll run with that too.
Yeah. I made you do it for a long time.
No, we're all.
Jordan. Yeah. Why?
Because if I have to change my blood, I want it to just still be my blood.
Good to know when this really happens. Okay, sorry, Jordan. You didn't get your good with your hands. Or... It's still a good answer.
4 minutes of you, Joe. If you guys are too tired, we won't do it. I went to storage the other day, and I found some things, and I felt tremendous empathy for you guys, because as I looked through them, I was really curious as to how they were ever really things, but I figured you guys probably suffered through a lot of our shit in the old days, like our things that you bought, and you rushed out, and you made your parents buy you this stuff, and it was really bad, so found a puzzle, a 100-piece puzzle. I figured, John, you're good at building shit, so maybe you might build it.
Thank you.
But I was thinking maybe we'll try one of these things. I found the new kid's microphone. I did test it out. What a piece of shit. Sorry to your parents, or those of you who had jobs. You need an FM radio to use the microphone, which I just discovered 40 years after the toy came out. So again, apologies if your parents had to buy one of these. They have batteries if you guys want to try it. Guys, I'm going to try this one regardless. Cassette bubblegum. Did anyone try this in the old days?
I found the cassette.
I'm going to try it tonight. Well, I won't make it to prom, will I? Thank you so much. New Kids cards, they were actually okay. The candy disc twist for candy necklace.
Haven't seen them.
Was this bootleg?
No.
Was it? This is official. It says Topps. That's the baseball card company. If anyone wants a candy disc necklace, guys, here you go. Put it on. The candy has totally been corrupted, so we won't eat it because we don't want to miss the prom tonight. And I'm sorry, Joe. One last one. I thought we could really... I've never gotten in this, and I don't know if you guys have, but I thought maybe a couple of us could try to get in it. A new kid sleeping bag! It smells like mold.
I brought that on a camping trip once.
Did you get in it? Will you guys get in it with me?
You just said it smells like mold.
Yeah, but we love each other.
I think this is a Jordan and Donnie moment, yeah. Actually. Yeah. Go ahead.
They share a lot.
I'll zip you up.
One more. Three of us. Can I? Wait, you're going in the back? You on the back? Should we do it standing up? Okay, laying down. Okay. Wait, you're going behind?
We can touch bums.
I don't think we'll fit that way.
We don't have to spoon
it. Spoon it.
No, it's only official if we spoon.
There you go.
This is for small kids. We're going to have to get really close.
Leave it to John.
This feels really good, actually. Yeah.
I feel things I didn't expect to come in contact with.
Get closer, closer. Closer. Almost there. Oh, hey.
Oh, jeez!
Oh,
yeah!
Oh,
shit! We're going closer. We're intertwined.
Almost.
No, our legs are intertwined. I feel things on my thigh. Are we pretty zipped?
Are we in?
We're
no.
In.
Halfway.
You made it to the butt. You made it to the booty.
Can you guys see us? Here, let's roll over so Jordan can see. Can you guys roll us over?
Yeah, roll. Roll over. Roll over.
First one to fart wins.
I think that already happened for both of us.
I'm really comfortable.
Take a nap right now.
This toy might have been worth the money, guys. Don't hold your mic near your ass, Jordan. There you go. All right. We better get up.
Good job.
Get some dinner! Get dressed up. We don't know what the prom is going to be, but it's going to be the dream we all dreamed all those years.